ప్రపన్న పారిజాతాయ తోత్ర వేత్రైకపాణయే జ్ఞానముద్రాయ కృష్ణాయ గీతామృత దుహే నమః. ఓం. డియర్ ఫ్రెండ్స్, వెల్కమ్ టు ది స్టడీ ఆఫ్ గీత. వీఆర్ కమింగ్ టు ద ఎండ్ ఆఫ్ ద 8th చాప్టర్ ఆఫ్ ద గీత. ది 8th చాప్టర్ 27th శ్లోక వీ జస్ట్ రెడ్ ఎస్టర్డే. దట్ ఈస్ వీ హవ్ సీన్ అర్లియర్ Krishna was describing two paths. One is a higher level path and the other is a lower level path. The higher level path is something which is called Devayana or the path of the gods. The lower level path is called the path of the forefathers or ancestors. So the higher level path leads to a higher place called Hiranyagarbhaloka. From there, from where he gets enlightened, a person gets enlightened. The lower level path takes to a place, what is called heavenly worlds, some loka, etc., etc. And from there is a avruti. Avruti means return. So this is what we have seen. So this shloka, 27th shloka, Krishna is saying that a person who knows these two, he will not be enamored, he will not get entangled in this karma path, totally in the karma path, always doing some karma, always doing some yajna, always seeking some punyam, etc., etc. So in fact, we see that right from the Upanishadic time, There is a debate about the limitations of these Mimamsakas. We know that there is what is called Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa. In the Indian systems of philosophy, there is what is called Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa. Of course, there are other things also like Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Sankhya, Yoga, and Sankhya means not what we read in Gita, Sankhya philosophy of Kapila. Yoga of Patanjali, Yoga of Patanjali, then again Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa. These are called the six systems of Astika Darshanas. Those Darshanas are those schools of thought which accepted the supremacy of the Vedas, authenticity of the Vedas. Then, not authenticity, authority of the Vedas. Then, in these, Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa, again, there is slight not exactly friction, gradation. Uttara Mimamsa, that is Vedanta, it says, do not get stuck in this path alone. If you are stuck in this path alone, your achievement is limited. You come to the path of knowledge. You come to the path of knowledge so that you become enlightened, you become liberated. But in reality, the people who attain that higher level, that is the liberation, they are very, very small in number, whereas the people who are in this world, all these worldly affairs, and then who do this, who are in the path of this yajna, yaga, etc., etc., all of us, most of us, we come under this particular category. But Krishna is saying here, naite sruti partha janam yogi muhyati kashchana tasmat sarveshu kaleshu yoga yukto bhava arjuna. So what is the message to Arjuna? Krishna is saying, hey Arjuna, భవ యోగయుక్తో భవ, యోగయుక్తో భవ అర్జున, హే అర్జున యోగయుక్తో భవ. ఓ అర్జున, యూ బీ అసోసియేటెడ్ విత్ దిస్ యోగ. యోగ మీన్స్ ఇన్ దిస్ పర్టికులర్ కాంటెక్స్ట్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ధ్యాన యోగ. ధ్యాన యోగ మీన్స్ దట్ మెడిటేషన్ దట్ ఈస్ ఓంకార ధ్యానం అండ్ దట్ వాట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ సగుణ బ్రహ్మ ధ్యానం, సగుణ బ్రహ్మ ఉపాసన. సో దట్ ఈస్ వాట్ ఈస్ టోల్డ్ హియర్. సో ఇన్ ద ఫస్ట్ లైన్ సేస్, నైతే శృతి పార్థ జానన్, హే పార్థ, ఏతే శృతి జానన్ యోగి న ముహ్యతి. నైతే, నైతే ఈజ్ నా ప్లస్ ఏతే, నా ప్లస్ ఏతే, దట్ నా కనెక్ట్స్ టు ముహ్యతి, న ముహ్యతి. హే పార్థ, ఏతే శృతి జానన్, ఎ పర్సన్ హూ నోస్ దీస్ టూ పాస్, న ముహ్యతి మీన్స్ డస్ నాట్ గెట్ డెల్యూడెడ్, డస్ నాట్ గెట్ ఎంటాంగిల్డ్, డస్ నాట్ గెట్ ఎనామర్డ్ బై దిస్ పాత్ ఆఫ్ కర్మ. యోగి ముహ్యతి కశ్చన, నోబడి, కశ్చన మీన్స్ నో వన్, కశ్చన సంబడి, నో వన్, న కశ్చన మీన్స్ నోబడి, న కశ్చన ముహ్యతి దట్ మీన్స్ నోబడి గెట్స్ డెల్యూడెడ్. ఎ పర్సన్ హూ నోస్ హీ విల్ నాట్ గెట్ డెల్యూడెడ్, ఓన్లీ ఎ పర్సన్ హూ డస్ నాట్ నో గెట్ డెల్యూడెడ్. సో తస్మాత్ దేర్ ఫోర్ సర్వేషు కాలేషు అట్ ఆల్ టైమ్స్ యోగి యోగయుక్తో భవార్జున, అట్ ఆల్ టైమ్స్ యూ హ్యావ్ టు బీ ఇన్ దట్ ధ్యాన నిష్ట. That is on the path of this devotion, on the path of this upasana, on the path of this saguna upasana, Hiranyagarbha upasana, so that you attain what is called the Hiranyagarbha loka, and from there is a phased liberation, what is called krama mukti. So he says, don't get deluded in that kamya karma. You are now aware of what is what, so don't get deluded in that kamya karma. Then the last shloka. The last shloka is, that is shloka number 28. So where he says again, he is again talking about what is called krama mukti. The final message for Arjuna is that Arjuna has to, of course he has to do his swadharma. While doing swadharma, you can also follow this path of bhakti. So that is what he is saying. You follow this path of bhakti and also do your swadharma. Vedeshu yajneshu tapasu jaiva, daneshu yat punya phalam pradishtam, atyeti tat sarvam idam viditva yogi paramsthanam upaiti chadyam. Vedeshu yajneshu tapasu jaiva, daneshu yat punya phalam pradishtam. So whatever punya phalam, whatever merit has been told about the performance of, about regarding the performance of Vedic studies, Vedeshu means all this is in Saptami Vibhakti, that is in locative case. Vedeshu means in the study of Vedas. That means not merely studying the Vedas but also practicing that Vedic lay of Vedic discipline. Suppose we have got a particular discipline. The same Vedic discipline is continuing even today. If you see the orthodox people, suppose you see some of these yajnikas, some of these orthodox people who wake up very early in the morning, who perform their Sandhya Vandana before before daybreak, before the sun rises, and they also perform one Madhyanika Sandhya Vandana sometime in the midday, and again they do before sunset. So this is one small part. In addition to that, they are also supposed to do what are called Panchamaha Yajnas. We have seen in second Adhyaya and third Adhyaya. So I described them all. So this is the Vedic way of life, how in a very, very disciplined manner, the entire lifetime, he spends this entire life like a yajna. The entire life, I also told about a passage from Taittiriya Aranyakam, from the Taittiriya Aranyakam, where a person leads the entire life like a yajna only. It is just a totally dedicated life. So that is Vedeshu, that is by the proper study of Vedas and also by observing the Vedic discipline, not merely studying. Any scholar can study. Any scholar, maybe a Western scholar or somebody who does not even know tradition, he may study. But then he is not observing the discipline. So Vedeshu means a person who studies and follows the discipline. Similarly, Yajneshu, not merely theoretically knowing what is Yajna, but performing them in a very meticulous manner. And tapasu chaiva, the tapas is austerity, is a person who has attained some mastery on all these austerities. That means he is very sincerely performing various austerities. Then daneshu and various types of dana. We have got various types of dana. So daneshu, yat punya phalam pradishtam. So whatever punyam has been told, you do this yajna, you get this punyam. You do this some other study of Vedas, you do this punyam. So all this punyam is taking into account. So whatever punyam has been, pradishtam means something which has been told. Told about Vedas, about yajna, about tapas and about danam, whatever punya has been told about all these things. A person on this bright path, a person on this path of what is called Shuklagati, atyeti means atitya gachati, that means he goes beyond, he surpasses. Atiyeti means ati plus eti. Atiyeti, that is surpasses, he goes beyond. So some punyam has been told about dhanam, yajnam, etc., etc. But this man who is on this upasana path, because he attains that purity of mind, he is all his bad vasanas or samskaras have been eradicated, so his mind has become pure. So he is the fittest man for that enlightenment. So he attains that Hiranyagarbhaloka from where he gets enlightened. So atyeti tat sarvam idam viditva. Tat sarvam means that sarvam punyaphalam, all that punyaphalam he surpasses. Idam viditva. Idam viditva means by knowing this. By knowing this means what all has been told in this chapter. That is starting from the beginning, he told about all these seven questions were there, Adhyatma, Madhibhutam, etc., were there. So all these things if you know, so then you are knowing various grades, various levels, this is a hierarchy. There is a hierarchy in the bhakti. There is a hierarchy in this Saguna Brahma, Nirguna Brahma, etc. So, by knowing all this, you will not be deluded and you are surpassing all those who perform this yajnas, etc. Atyeti tas sarvam idam viditva yogi, yogi means dhyana yogi, paramsthanam upaiti cha adhyam, paramsthanam, that highest level, upaiti, upaiti means upa plus yeti, upaiti means he goes, he attains, adhyam, adhyam means the very first one, the very first cause, means that which is the cause for all the existence. So here the commentators have given two meanings for this adhyam, paramsthanam. Paramsthanam is the supreme status. Paramsthanam, supreme status, there are two levels. That is again, that Hiranyagarbha level and the supreme Brahman level. That supreme Brahman level, he will attain kramamukti, that is in a slow manner or a phased manner. Whereas this Hiranyagarbha level, he attains by following this Shukla path, by following this bright path. So here, yogi paramsthanam, that is Hiranyagarbhasthanam by Saguna Brahmopasana. And adhyam, adhyam is what? Adhyam is sarvakaranam, that is the cause for all, that supreme Brahman is the cause for all the being, for all the things. Because in that supreme Brahman, this whole manifesting power called Maya, and from that manifesting power only, all these things, they come, they evolve. That is what we have seen. And paramsthanam upaiti divyam. So that supreme Brahman, if you want to give the meaning paramsthanam as supreme Brahman, we have to say, not immediately. Paramsthanam upaiti, that is by krama mukti, that is he goes to that middle, that there is a particular majali. Majali means that particular way, the particular intermediate level. And in that level, he gets enlightened and he reaches that, or rather he attains that liberation. So that is where we complete the 8th chapter. We will just take a break and quickly have a small summary of this 8th adhyaya. Let us resume. We will just have a sort of summary of this 8th chapter, that is Ashtamadhyaya. This 8th chapter, as we recall, if you recall, it started with some vague words like adhibhutam, adhiyajnam, adhidaivam, adhyatmam, etc., etc. And all, so all those things, there were 7 points which were told. And these 7 points which were told in the last 2 shlokas of the 7th chapter, because last verses of one chapter normally connect to the next chapter. So similarly, this the last 2 shlokas of the 7th chapter formed the basis for this 8th chapter. So they started with 7 points and explaining the 7 points, and we saw this Brahma at 2 levels. Brahma means the God, let us say, at 2 levels. One is that higher level or the absolute level, and the other one is at the lower level. At the higher level, maybe God with a capital G, and the lower level, God with a small g, in the sense that it is what is called a Saguna Brahma. Saguna means a delimited Parichinna Brahma, that is Maya Vachinnam Brahma, that is the Brahman which is associated with that Maya, that is delimited by Maya, is called Saguna Brahma. So these 2 things we have seen, and we also saw 2 words called, that is one which is for worship, etc., the other which is supposed to be known. This Saguna Brahma is for worship. Saguna means, okay, you need a God form, you have to pour your requests on him, you have to cry over his shoulders. So that is called Upasya Brahma. Upasya means that which has to be worshipped. Upasana. Upasana is worship, isn't it? Upasana, meditation, worship. So Upasya Brahma, that is the lower level, that is one level. And the higher level is what is called that which has to be understood, that which has to be known by Shravana Manana Nididhyasana. That Shravana Manana Nididhyasana, we should not forget. Shravana means going to a teacher and listening to the Vedanta Vakyas, knowing what is Jiva, knowing what is Jagat, and knowing what is Brahman, and how this Jiva is not different from Brahman, etc. That is what is called Vichara, Viveka and Vichara. So that is the higher level, Gneya. Gneya means that which has to be understood, that which has to be known. And the moment you know it, you also know that you are not different from that. So that is Gneya Brahma. So this Upasya Brahma and Gneya Brahma, these 2 words also we saw in this 8th adhyaya, right from the beginning. So this Upasya Brahma, when you are worshipping a God, there is this notion of duality. I am different and God is different. Whereas in this higher level thing, when you have understood it, understood that Brahman, you also realize that you are that. So that duality ceases to exist. So there is what is called a non-duality, ananya. Even if we call it bhakti, it is called ananya bhakti. Then in this duality, there is what is called the I, the notion of I present. I am the servant and the Lord is my master. This I, this master-servant relationship is there. Whereas in this higher level thing, that is Jnaya Brahma, where you are understanding what is that Satyam, that supreme reality, so that ego that obliterates, gets obliterated. That means there is no longer that I totally dissolves. I means that capital I. That capital I totally dissolves, that ego totally dissolves. When we say Aham Brahmasmi, it is not an egotistical statement. It is a statement in which the ego is totally obliterated. And you are seeing, not when you say Aham Brahma, it does not mean Aham Ano, I alone am Brahman. It means that you are Brahman. It is everything else is Brahman. That stone is Brahma. The dog is Brahma. Shunichaiva, Shvapakesha, everything is that manifestation in that Brahman. So he is in that level of awareness. So that ego is completely dissolved or obliterated. So this Upasya Brahma, in which there is a focusing of mind and meditating on that. Whereas Jnaya Brahma, it is by Vichara, by Viveka, as I said, Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana. So this is the basic difference between Upasya Brahma and Jnaya Brahma. Then again, we saw another interesting point called Antya Bhavana. Antya, Antam means end. Antya Bhavana means the final frame of mind. A person at the time of death, what is his frame of mind? So Krishna was saying, even at that time, if a person is in the right path, he will attain a good loka. So that is what he was saying, that final frame of mind. And that sort of frame of mind cannot be built up all of a sudden. It has to be built up over a period of time. All through the life you have been busy with your business, you have been busy with your acquisition of properties, etc., and dealing with so many worldly things. And at the final moment, you want to know what is that Brahma, you want to know what is that, you want to do some upasana, etc. The mind does not accept it, because in the mind, there is so much accumulation of all these vasanas. So these vasanas have to be eradicated over a period of time. So otherwise, the vasanas, that huge bundle, cannot be obliterated by simply playing some cell phone, and then in that cell phone you make him listen to Gita or something like that. That simply does not go. That simply does not get accepted in the mind. So that Antya Bhavana, it is for that the samskaras can be eradicated only by Abhyasa and Vairagya. We have seen those two terms. By long practice and also developing dispassion. Vairagya is dispassion. And again, particularly from verses number 8 to 15, we saw what is called Upasana, Upasana Paddhati. In this Upasana Paddhati, Krishna was telling, he was actually combining the practices which are told in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, how Bhruvor Madhye Pranamaveshya Samyak. Bhruvor Madhye means in the middle of the brows. Middle of the brows, pranam avesya, this prana shakti has to be brought up from Mooladhara. Then we also had a reference to what are called the six chakras in the body. That is six, what can we say, centers, energy centers we can say, or six systems maybe symbolically. One is that food system, the other is water system, then another is that fire, Agni Tattvam, whatever is Agni Tattvam, what is called Mooladhara, Swadhisthana. Then again, Manipura Chakra, Anahata Chakra, etc., we saw. And the six chakras. So that means, what we see figuratively is, the grosser thing is at the lowest, like Bhumi is the grossest thing. Above it is water, above it is fire, above it is air, above it is space. So similarly, the human being is structured. The first thing is Bhumi, that is Mooladhara. The second thing is water, then the third thing which is here is fire, then again air, then space, then again Ajna. Ajna means something like the command center I was telling you. Ajna is something which is associated with some small amount of Jnana. It is not complete Jnana. Ajna is a little, some small amount of Jnana. not complete jnana, because you are able to perceive things, you are able to know things. So whatever at least is known by, knowable by the senses. So there is Ajna Chakra, that is a command center, let us say. So these two things, these things we saw, some interesting things. And in between, he also talked, Krishna also talked about Omkara Upasana. Omkara we had fairly long discussion even earlier. That is, Omkara can be seen as a symbol, a mere symbol, like an idol is a symbol for Lord Venkateshwara, or Lord Narasimha, or Lord Shiva, etc. Or Omkara is also something which directly denotes Brahma, which directly explains Brahma. One is symbol, the other one is it explains, explanatory. One is what is called pratika. Pratika is symbol. The other one is vachakam. Vachakam means it is explanatory. How is Omkara explaining Brahma or totally expressing Brahma? That is Omkara. We have seen how that Auma structure is there. How that whole, the entire Shabda Prapancha, the whole world of word, the whole world of Shabda, all the words, all human learning, all human literature, all human expressions, they form part of that Au and Ma. That means all human experience, past, present and future, it is all experience, it is all expressed by that. And all human experience during day, that is day, Jagradavastha, Swapna and deep sleep, all those things, they are also included. So in that fashion, the entire human experience, past, present and future is contained in that Om. So that is how, and this Om is something which again merges in what is called Turiya, that is a silence. That silence where this mind also ceases, that is what is Brahman. So long as the mind is there, it is not Brahman. The mind also has to dissolve, and when the mind dissolves, there is pure consciousness. And that pure consciousness, that ocean-like consciousness is what is called Brahma. So that is what we saw, that how that Omkara represents. And Omkara Upasana, again a person who is not able to do that Vichara, he may do Upasana. By doing that Omkara Upasana, he gets Karma Mukti, that phased liberation. That is also what we saw. Then again, there is some interesting discussion about what are called the Loka, Lokas. Then Krishna was saying, Ah Brahma Bhuvanal Lokaha Punaravartino Arjuna. There was an interesting discussion on what was called eschatology. Eschatology is what happens after death, what happens to the world at the time of, say, dissolution. Religions talk about what is called the great deluge or the day of judgment, etc. So like that, what exactly is this, what happens? So there, what happens, we are not talking about sinners and all that who go to hellish worlds. We are only talking about the good people. And among the good people, there are grades. So, that gradation is seen. Loka, what is the meaning of loka? Loka, again, we have to take the philosophical meaning. Loka does not mean that it is some sort of three-dimensional space, a three-dimensional thing, which world, which is somewhere located somewhere in the space. Like this Earth, this planet, or Mars, or Saturn, or Jupiter. It's not some such place. Loka does not mean that. Lokyate iti lokaha. Vedanta says, lokyate means anubhuyate. It is a sort of experiential state. A person after departing, after leaving the body, the linga sharira or the subtle body is still there, and the subtle body is in that particular experiential state. So it experiences a state called Brahmaloka, a state called what is called Indraloka or some other Chandraloka or some other lokam. And depending on the amount of punyam, they stay in that Devaloka and come back. That is one level. The other thing is, there is another higher level called Brahmaloka, that is Hiranyagarbhaloka. From there, the people who have done this Upasana, the people who have attained purity of mind, basically the purity of mind is what is stressed all through Vedanta, what we see is that purity of mind. A person, even in karma yoga, a person attains some purity of mind. But then, it is not like in this Upasana Marga. In this Upasana Marga, he is totally hooked on to this idea of God. He is in that mode, Upasana mode. So, the dualities in his mind, they have all gone away. When all the dualities in his mind have gone away, then he has attained that purity of mind, which is fit enough that mind is fit enough for the next level, that is enlightenment. So he is said to attain a higher loka. From there, that linga sharira also dissolves and then he becomes one with that Brahman. So that is what we have seen in that loka. Lokyate anubhuyate. Then again, we saw another interesting thing called the cycles of creation. The cycles of creation, we also saw the time span, how Indian, our way of calculating time. That is because our basic premise, our major premise is that consciousness is something which never dies. And this consciousness has got this expressive power called Maya. And that Maya means that is all this Jagat, etc. So when was this Jagat created? So religion may say, okay, it was created so and so time. But our basic premise is that consciousness is eternal. When consciousness is eternal, then naturally there cannot be any time limit. So the time goes on eternally. So we have to tell about something, the cycles of creation. It goes on, creation, sustenance, resolution. Creation, sustenance and resolution. So basing on that, certain hypothesis has been made. So this creator Brahma also is an expression. Creator Brahma also is a sort of it is an expression in that supreme reality. And this expression, like a wave is always not there. In that ocean, let us say a wave emerges. That wave is always not there. A wave also, it merges again, and again another wave comes. So like that, all these waves of creation, all these cycles of creation go on and on and on. So that is the reason why the Indian concept of time is something which almost coincides with what the scientists tell about the origin of the universe, etc. So that is one interesting point which we saw. Then finally, when we come to the end, we saw what is called Devayana and Pitruyana. In fact, yesterday and even today, we were just discussing this bright path and the dark path. So the person, a realized person, and for a realized person, he is above these two paths. A bright path is for a upasaka. The dark path is for somebody who is doing yajna. And the enlightened person, there is no bright path or dark path because he is already a mukta. He is already a liberated person. The moment the body falls, the linga sharira totally dissolves. So there are three levels of people we saw. Then what is the final message to Arjuna? The final message to Arjuna is, you have to do your swadharma. And yoga yukto bhava Arjuna, tasmad yoga yukto bhava. Yoga yukto bhava means what? You always be in that dhyana yoga mode. You do your swadharma and also follow this upasana path. In fact, if we see Mahabharata, Bhishma is a very great example for that. Bhishma is actually a wise man. And in the end, if we see this moksha dharma parva and this anushasana parva and shanti parva, there are some sub-parvas there like Moksha Dharma Parva, etc. So where Bhishma is talking about this Vishnu Sahasranama, there he is telling so many things about this Moksha Dharmas. So Bhishma is one such upasaka. So like that, there are certain examples. So the final message to Arjuna is he has to be on that path. And the message for all the people also is that don't be stuck in rituals only, come to slightly higher level. It does not mean that we are condemning religion. You be, so as far as possible, try to rise above. So that is what is the final message. Let us continue tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.